Hi, it's Kevin Lebates here. So I got asked an interesting question, namely, what does a 51% attack look like in a proof of stake blockchain? Now, in a proof of work blockchain, if you have 51% of the hashing power, then you can basically go off and, instead of mining the main chain, mine a parallel chain in which you reverse some transactions, and that allows you to execute a double spend. Now, one of the things that's always struck me about the proof of work double spend attack is that presumably you would be mining alongside everybody else, and so there should be an indicator that something is up if suddenly half the hashing power disappears. So I'm guessing that a proof of work 51% attack is done stealthily, i.e. you don't mine, you just amass the hashing power and then you turn it on to mine the parallel chain. Presumably you're renting computer power or something like that, because of course it's ridiculous to spend a vast fortune on mining equipment and then just have it sitting there doing nothing. But anyway, back to the question, 51% proof of stake attack. Well, proof of stake is different because you can actually mine multiple branches of a blockchain simultaneously, because the computational overhead is very, very low. If you have a large quantity of the native tokens of the blockchain that are used for staking, then there's nothing to stop you having a go at generating blocks at any point along the chain. The issue there is that if you only have a small percentage, then after you've mined one of these blocks, your next block that you're mining, or rather minting, there's this concept of difficulty in proof of stake too, and the difficulty level of your subsequent blocks will be much lower than the main chain, and so you won't succeed. However, if you own a large majority of the tokens, then the probability that it's one of your tokens that is selected to mine or mint the next block again and again becomes much, much higher. It's still a probabilistic thing, so there's a risk associated with submitting a transaction and then trying to create a parallel chain, in that you just might be very unlucky. On the other hand, with a smallish stake, say 33%, you may be very, very lucky in your attack. So there isn't really quite the same thing as a 51% attack. Actually, both kind of attacks have probabilities associated with them. They're not guaranteed. It's more a matter of the more hashing power, or the more coins to stake that you have, the more likely it is that you'll be able to successfully execute such an attack. But anyway, yes, there are attacks that proof of stake coin holders who hold a large quantity of the staking coin can undertake. One of them is the nothing at stake problem, which is what I was talking about, where you can basically go ahead and mint blocks on the top of any valid looking chain without any problem. And in fact, Ethereum combats this by having a penalty whereby if you submit a block to the network that is on a parallel chain that doesn't become the canonical chain, then you actually lose some of your stake. So I think that actually touches on one of the things that you can do with proof of stake, which is you can have penalties for people who have a go at trying to subvert the system. You can have protocols in your consensus system that take stake off people, or percentage of stake off people who do naughty things. It's a topic that's probably worth digging into a bit more deeper, so I'll make a note to produce another video on this sometime soon. But that's the basic overview. Yes, there is a proof of stake 51%-ish kind of attack, but ultimately, the main thing that I think that keeps proof of stake honest is that people have spent a lot of money buying their coins, and as a result, you're kind of relying on them not being malicious, because they've got something at stake in the system. They've got skin in the game. Anyway, bye for now. See you in the next video soon.